So normally I don't use hammers on bearings, but what I wanted to do today was do a video on bearings used in manual transmissions and probably transmissions in general. You see, there's a lot of hype on the internet, a lot of misinformation, so I wanted to clear some things up. So in a little opening there, I showed you actually how a typical ball bearing gets disassembled or assembled, if you want to think of it in backwards terms, how we go back together again. I think if I give you an explanation of how these bearings actually work, some of the hype on the internet and the misinformation, you'll understand better, and you'll be able to figure out for yourself what is actually good information and bad information. Let's get to it. So that bearing I just took apart is a typical open style ball bearing. It's called a deep groove ball bearing or a Conrad style bearing. I don't know where the name Conrad comes from. I think it probably has something to do with concentric and radial type of bearings. But these are called deep groove bearings. And the deep groove means that this groove inside here is deep. And the ball fits in the groove like this. This is your inner ring or inner race. And this is your outer ring or outer race. What I try to explain to people is that loads on bearings, you have what's called a radial load, which is based on the radius of the bearing. Or think of it up and down this way. In terms of gear trains, load that's going to try to push the bearing this way. And you have axial loads going through the center axis of the bearing. And that's like a thrust load. It's going to push the bearing and try to push the bearing this way. So you have also a thing in some bearing catalogs called dynamic load, which is some equation of both radial and axial loads put together. You have a typical open style bearing. You have what's called a shielded style bearing. If you notice, these are metal shields on the bearing. Sometimes they could be single shields on one side and it could be open on another side, or it can be double shielded. The shield helps keep dirt and debris out of the bearing but still allows oil to flow through the bearing. A lot of times in manual transmissions it's good to use shielded bearings because it cuts down in windage in the transmission and keeps dirt from getting into the bearing. And remember, in a manual transmission there is no filter. Latest transmissions seem to come with seals in them now. Seals work really well. I find that with sealed bearings, there's absolutely zero bearing failures. Again, most bearing failures are from dirt and debris and not overload at this point. Bearings are pretty well designed. So let's get back to this particular bearing here. This is a standard, what we call a 307 bearing. There's 307 bearings in all different shapes and sizes. And I wanted to show people some differences of the same bearing, and there was the same variation of the bearing. And so you get a better understanding. First of all, in the Muncie four-speed application for Muncie transmissions, originally the Muncie transmission, when it came out in 1963, used what's called a 207 style bearing, and noticed how thin it is. And they had problems with this tiny bearing failing. So they were able to fit a bigger diameter bearing in the case, but they couldn't go wider. So what they did was, in other words, they wanted to have a bearing diameter of this style, which is called a 307 bearing, but the same width of the 207 bearing. You can see the difference in the width. So thus they came out with a narrow 307 bearing. So this bearing here, it's got the same outside diameter, same inside diameter, but it's narrow. Okay? It's also important to notice something about bearings that a lot of people don't pick up, is the chamfer of the inner ring right over here. You can see that it has a chamfer to it, all right? Compared to some bearings that have no chamfer at all. Kind of, we call this a square inner ring. And sometimes that's very crucial in how a bearing actually fits on a shaft, what's going to thrust against it. The snap ring, for example, is it going to have enough support and so forth. So a lot of times when you're using a bearing that has a chamfer and you have to put a snap ring on it, they may have a washer that goes over it so the snap ring has a nice full contact to ride against in the bearing. So that's very important. Using the wrong bearing with the wrong type of chamfer can lead to snap rings blowing off and a failure. Now, another misconception is that this bearing is going to be weaker than this bearing because this bearing is wider. The fact of the matter is the raceways are the same, and I'll show you. We're going to take a bearing that we took apart, and we're going to take a bearing in a ring from a narrow setup. And you could see that the raceways are the same, exactly the same. Support is the same, there's no difference. So
The balls are the same diameter, the raceways are the same diameter, the raceways are the same radius, everything's the same. So a narrow 307 bearing is not any weaker than a regular standard 307 bearing. So there's people that are buying kits to put big 307 bearings in early months, these are wasting their money. Another thing people overlook is snap ring groove location. Here we have a 307 bearing. Notice it's got a square and a ring. This is actually for a Chrysler 3-speed application. But notice the snap ring groove, it's hard to see in this black one, is much bigger than this one. So again, it looks like the same bearing, but if you look carefully, this snap ring groove is much smaller than this snap ring groove, which will place the bearing in a different location or actually make the bearing move if you were using it in this application. So when looking at bearings again, here we have a bearing that's got a square and a ring. This has got a radius to it, and they're not the same. They're not for the same application. Even though they have the same amount of balls and the same amount of diameters in both the outside and the inside, they're not really identical bearings. So another thing you always hear about is maximum capacity bearings. Bearings that have more balls in them compared to, say, regular Conrad style bearings. Okay. Now, if we're looking into loads, okay, obviously this bearing is going to be able to take more of a load or a radial load up and down than this bearing will because it has more balls in it. The balls are the same diameter, same radius of the raceways. Everything's the same except this one has more balls. Except that this bearing has slots to put the balls in. Some people call these filling slot bearings. So if I line these slots up like that, you could see where they would place the ball in there. Normally the bearing would go together like the regular bearings do, where you put the race offset, put maybe 8 balls in, and then put the rest of the balls in through the slots. Here's the problem. When it comes to axial loads, depending on the direction, axial loads go down to nothing. So these bearings are good for radial loads, but for thrust load applications, they can fail and have less of a rating than these. The problem with dynamic load ratings in catalogs is that the fact is multiply this by a certain application so much for radial that it gets the dynamic load way up. So in this application where you have spur type gears, using a max capacity bearing is great because for the most part, this gear set is only going to produce a radial load up and down. The gears are going to try to pull themselves apart. So a max capacity bearing like this is really good. But now suppose we're using a gear that's helical, like this one. Now what we've introduced is a radial load as well as an axial load. So the big misconception that you see is that using one of these bearings is going to be okay, when in fact it's not, because the axial load produced by this gear set will work against these filling slots and blow the bearing apart eventually. You can see here that the filling slot of the bearing actually cuts into the inner raceway. And what that does is that reduces the thrust capacity of the bearing. If the ball actually pushes against that area, there's going to be no thrust load and the bearing's going to blow apart or damage. Same thing for the outer race. You'll see that the filling slot as well cuts into the raceway. Another thing is the cages. Because obviously you have more balls, you're going to have more heat generated with these bearings. Therefore, in race applications, they can generate quite a bit more heat than a standard open-type bearing. The cages will generate more friction because they have these kind of separators in them. Balls go against these separators and generate more heat. I've seen a lot of this happen where the cage actually heats up and actually drops down on the inner ring, scuffs against it, and puts more metal into the bearing. The bearing wears rapidly.
So we have a lot of people selling these. They're a lot more money than standard bearings, but they really do not work properly. You're better off using a simple bearing like this with shields or seals on it. Matter of fact, GM has been doing this for years. They ditched this program because they found out that these bearings actually wore rapidly, caused a lot of warranty issues compared to these. That simple. Ball bearings come in a variety of sizes. This is for a Mitsubishi transmission, Chrysler, probably for some sort of like Sebring or something like that. I don't know. And they have different size numbers on them. These are not standard sizes. This is by NSK. It says here, B25-139. These are special bearings for manual transmissions. This bearing is another type of bearing that was used in a lot of Japanese transmissions,
where they have these kind of series of the 63/32 style bearings. They're very similar looking, but they have very oddball sizes and very oddball metric sizing, usually specific for manual transmissions. Now here we have a clutch bearing. This is something different. So let's get into clutch bearings and let me show you how these clutch bearings actually work. So clutch release bearings simply are a bearing that needs to be used primarily for axial loads going this way. It's going to be pushing against the clutch, pressing the fingers in. So the load is strictly on the face of the bearing. Now there's all sorts of different bearing faces designed and built around simply a thrust bearing type of application, where you're going to have a thrust bearing with two outside races, and they're going to be housed in some fancy arrangement. You can actually see in here, you can actually see the thrust bearing and the different races on the outside, just that it's housed specially for an application and much beefier, because these have to ride against the clutch fingers, so this has to be hardened and special and all of that. But in general, that's what a release bearing, how it works. Next up is tapered cups and cones. This is a front bearing for a T5 transmission. And this here is also a bearing for a T5 transmission. And it's actually also used as a pinion bearing in many 12-volt Chevy rear ends. And you can see that there's difference in sizes, okay? Surprisingly, this particular setup, this is called your cone, this is called your race, so, or cup. So, cone bearing, cup and cone bearing, all right? And they go together like this. Cup and cone bearings or tapered bearings can have an incredible amount of axial load capacity this way because they have a taper to them. The drawback to these is that you're gonna have to have shims and you're gonna have to have some sort of preload to keep them together. Like when you do wheel bearings in a car or pinion bearings again in the rear axle. The different types of angles of these bearings, you can see that this one has more of a severe angle on the right here compared to the one on the left, will produce a higher axial load capacity. So they make them all different sizes and shapes, and they work pretty much the same way. Again, what's good about these types of bearings is that this particular bearing can have a very small form factor and actually sometimes be equivalent in load rating to a bearing this size, providing, of course, you have to build into the design the ability to have it shimmed so that you can keep these two pieces together. The disadvantage of these bearings is that any slight movement, in other words, if this thing were ever to come apart, it falls off very quickly. So you lose clearances. They develop larger quite rapidly if you have any type of end play that exceeds your specification of the transmission. If you've got a 3,000th end play and you go to 5,000th end play, this thing could drop off way down and you can blow your gears up. So critical setup on tapered bearings is very important. And can't tell you how much that's very critical. Okay, let's go on to drawn cup needle rollers. Drawn cup needle rollers are used in a lot of transmissions. Some have open, these are open drawn cup rollers. By that they mean that this cup here is actually drawn through a drawing process. And if you see that this particular bearing has separators in it, so this is called just a standard drawn cup bearing, where this is same thing on this bearing, small bearing, you can see, different size. Again, needles with separators in them. Sometimes you can have needle bearings that are open without a cup with just separators, like this. They only work, obviously, in radial load applications. They cannot take any thrust load at all. They're not designed for that. So this particular bearing over here, same thing, smaller, but a cage style bearing. Let's see what we got here. And this little bearing here, if you can see up in here, you can see that it's called a full complement bearing. It has all the needles stacked together without any cage in between them or separator. Now this is good for load, but the problem is in high speed applications, it can generate more heat and more skewing. So cage needles sometimes are better for high speed applications where you're not too concerned about too much radial load again this way, which you want to have a high speed application compared to something like this, which again can develop more heat, more skewing, more breakage. Here's a closed end drawn cup bearing, typically used in a T5 transmission, like the old non-world class. This is the front bearing, it's just bigger than the others. A little bit different design, full complement bearing again. See, no separators, all the bearings stacked into a cup. So if you're designing an application for a drawn cup style bearing, the specifications for the bearing housing bore, for example, will be in such a tolerance so that when this thing is pressed into the housing, it will conform to the specifications of the shaft it was intended for. Now this is what I wanted to show you about chamfers and ball bearings. This is very important. Here I show you that bearing that has a square inner ring. There's no chamfer at all on this one. And on this particular bearing, there's quite a bit of a chamfer on the inner ring. This is a first design Super T10 main shaft. This is actually out of a Ford Galaxy, I believe like a 64-65 type of Galaxy transmission. And the first speed gear rides over here. It rides against the synchronizer assembly. The first gear rides on this part of the main shaft over here. And if you see here, you have this very thin edge. So normally what will happen is, I think this is press fit, so the square inner ring is going to go down against this thing, and it's going to act as a thrust surface for the first gear to thrust against. If I put this bearing on here that doesn't have a square inner ring, guess what's going to happen? It's going to go past this surface, go up against the gear more, and lock it up and burn the unit out. So again, when people are selling rebuild kits for, say, for example, Super T10 first design, rear bearing has to have a square inner ring. If it's got a tapered inner ring and you don't check that out, it's going to go in past this edge, because look at how thin that edge is. It's a very thin edge. It's going to go past that edge, lock up the first gear, and smoke the unit. All right, let's talk about bearing wear. I've showed you all the different styles of bearings, but how do they wear and how you can prevent them from wearing out? So in a manual transmission, it has two things that are really bad. It has no filtration system, and it has no pressurized oil feed. Automatic transmissions, on the other hand, they usually have some sort of filtration system for the oil, and they also have pressurized feed oil going to all sorts of various parts of the transmissions. They usually call that some sort of lube circuit for the oil. So in manual transmissions, what they do is usually they have magnetic fill and drain plugs or some sort of magnetic somewhere to catch the ferrous metals that may be floating around in the transmission. But the non-ferrous metals will simply just kind of float around in the oil. So it's always a good idea to change your oil about every 10,000 miles in your manual transmission. A lot of people think it's there forever. You shouldn't do that. Again, contamination of the oil is the number one cause of bearing failure in manual transmissions. The other is misalignment of shafts. We talk about this all the time about dialing in your bell housing. So if you have your crankshaft here and your input shaft here and everything's aligned properly, no problem. But if something goes out of kilter and the input shaft is kind of like this, what happens is that bearing now gets a side load put up against it, works harder on the bearing race, and blows it apart. Oftentimes, it's very common to see the bearings actually shatter in applications where there's huge misalignment issues, as well as sometimes people forget to put the pilot bushing in a new crankshaft or a new engine that they purchase, and the bearings blow out. If you do have a car that you've got your transmission that's constantly wiping out front bearings, you may want to look into that as a possible reason, because usually front bearings and transmissions actually last a very long time. So again, if you have a misalignment issue, you know, you may not get a week or two out of them sometimes. So that's a little tip. Let's go look at some worn bearings. Let's go back to our standard 307 bearing. Let's take a look at the bearing, how it works, right? Spins beautiful. And a lot of times people make the mistake where they spin bearings. You hear that? And you hear some noise and they go, oh, the bearing's bad. This bearing is just dirty from being around the shop. That's all. It's just got dirt in it. If you were to clean this bearing out and oil it, it'll be fine. It's very hard to see bearing races be bad. Okay, this is a brand new bearing. So people have a habit of looking at a bearing and saying, oh my God, it's made in China, must be bad. Or it's made in Japan, it's not US, and I spin it and I hear noise. Well, they could have gotten dust in the bearing. So all it takes is a simple amount of dust in the bearing inside here, because the clearances are very tight for it to make noise. So what you want to do is thoroughly check the bearing with a light and get inside here. And if you're inspecting a bearing, look for little cracks and crevices or things like that, or any types of spalling on the races. And let me show you what that looks like. Here's a bearing. You could see the race is destroyed. You could see all these pits that it's been spalling. And if you take notice of how this race is worn, you can actually see that this side is worn more than the other side. So you can actually see where the thrust load is on this race. You can see it's pretty much hammered on this side, right? Look at that. You can see that it's hammered on this side, yet this side is clean. Look at that. So you could see that this particular bearing was subject to a thrust load or an axial load, and that's what really took this bearing out. And more than that, you could see the direction that it was going, and it obviously it was going towards this side more than this side, because you could see how this area, again, is super clean on this edge compared to this area, which is all peened over and destroyed. When it comes to checking wear on tapered bearings, it's a little bit more easier because the cup is exposed and you can easily look at the cup raceway and see that it's nice and clean. On a tapered bearing like this, you can actually just spin it around, look, and you can see here that this needle on the tapered bearing is actually worn. You can see that there. Okay, so this is a bad bearing. It might have been making noise. You could feel the rough spots, but again, the best way to check is to look to see if you actually have physical wear. Sometimes you can look inside this way and see, but this is quite obvious to wear on this particular bearing.
And then, of course, there's the dreaded needle bearings. And needle bearings are just loose needles that you have to put inside a transmission with some sort of grease. The easiest thing about needle bearings is that it's very easiest to see if they're worn or not. Let me show you something.
So here you have your loose needle bearings. A lot of transmissions have them in them, usually on the counter gears, but also some of the Jaguar, the old Jaguar 4-speeds actually have them on the each individual speed gear. And you have to manually load these in with grease or some sort of compound to hold it in place. We have especially an assembly lube. So here you can see how I have these needles all loaded and packed with grease. And it's very easy to see if the shaft is worn that they're riding against, as well as if the inside of the gear is worn. This is a brand new gear and a brand new shaft, so of course nothing's worn. But in general, you simply pull them out one by one. You can check the needles. Usually they're cheap enough to scrap them and just get all new needles. And you want to check the surface of the gear itself that the needle rides on and the surface of the shaft that the needle also rides on.
So that's it. Thanks for watching. I hope you enjoyed this video on bearings, all the different styles of bearings and what they're used for. Hopefully it'll help you get a better understanding of the bearings and how they correlate to the different applications in transmission use. See you around. Please subscribe to my channel. Got a lot more videos coming up. Thanks for watching.